The following podcast contains mature language and spoilers. Listener discretion is advised.
That is awesome. And I want to just tell our listeners, if anybody's actually listening to this podcast, please tweet us at RolledSpine. I want to know what the weirdest things are you've taken into movie theaters or have observed taken in movie theaters. Thank you.
Okay. I've seen someone whip out a large pizza from Pizza Hut.
Get out of here, dude. A large pizza. You know, wait, was this in the 90s where they were in like JNCO jeans or something? All right. Hey, everybody. Welcome to Marvel Superheroes Podcast. I'm Igloo Machine. With me is
Mr. Fixit.
And we are going to talk to you about Thor, Love and Thunder, the fourth installment of Chris Hemsworth Thor anthology or whatever. I don't know what the hell they call it.
These hands were once used for battle. Now they're but humble tools for peace. I need to figure out exactly who I am. I want to choose my own path, live in the moment. My superheroing days are over.
What I told you. You ever feel lost? Just look into the eyes of the people that you love. Not me.
What? Just listening.
Okay, well, hold on. I got a quick question, Matt.
Yeah, go for it. Ask me.
So before we were going to podcast, I was riding around, running errands, and listening to some music. And Led Zeppelin, I hit the greatest hit. So I now realize that all of Zeppelin is now Thor adjacent to me. Anything I listen to, I immediately think of Thor. And so as I'm listening to this, I was curious, what did Robert Plant mean by, I want to be your backdoor man?
I tell you what, man.
Hold on. Does he want to sneak in at night and hook up with you?
Yes, that's my theory.
Or does he want to go down and dirty?
I think you're thinking of Brown Eye Girl.
So I was just wondering. Okay, so Love and Rock or Love and Thunder.
This movie is based on the Jason Aaron run loosely, right?
Yeah, I read that.
You were a fan of the Jason Aaron stuff, right? If I remember correctly, I remember you talking it up pretty big, right? Now, that was like years, right? How long did he write?
Oh, yeah, it was a while back. Funny note on that. That was the first digital comic I was downloading, because when you would buy the book, you'd get the little digital code. And I still have like almost the entire run. And I remember that was where I got introduced to Jason Aaron. Like, that was a damn... I remember enjoying it a lot. It's been a long time since I read it. I want to say it came out like 6 years ago, maybe?
Yeah, it says... Okay, so according to Marvel.com, his complete Thor saga is 7 years worth of stories, which includes Thor, God of Thunder, Unworthy Thor, Jane Foster as the Mighty Thor, and War of the Realms.
Okay. The War of the Realms is the only thing I didn't read.
Okay, it looks like it went from like 12 to 18 or 12 to 19 or something.
Sounds about right.
Looks about right. Okay, so you were a big fan of that. So you were familiar with Gore, the God Killer? God Slayer?
God Butcher.
Goodness gracious, I already screwed up the fucking name. So you were familiar with Gore, right? Was the Gore God Butcher stuff, is that one of the highlights of the run? Or did you like another chunk of stuff better?
That was like, I believe that's like the beginning, the first part of the run.
Okay.
Because after that, he becomes the Unworthy One, Unworthy Thor. And Jane Foster's running around as Thor, Mighty Thor. And the book, trying to think back, I think it starts pretty faithfully. The movie pretty much. I mean, the look different, of course. Thor looks more alien in the book, but it's pretty faithful from what I can remember the beginning. The only real big difference I remember is the time jump, because in the book, Thor had encountered Gore a long time ago and barely survived. And then we went to present time Thor, and then it would go to like future Thor, and they were kind of bouncing around. But I knew they wouldn't put that into it. That was just too much.
Yeah, he kind of looks like what's his in the comics, just looking at a picture of it. He looks like what's his name from Harry Potter. Oh. What's the bad guy's name in Harry Potter?
Oh, he who we do not speak of.
Fucking Mordor or whatever. Hey, what's the bad guy's name? What's the bad guy's name? Is it Sauron?
No.
Oh, gee. Oh, Voldemort. That's Voldemort. Right. You're right. Yeah, he looks like Voldemort in the comics. Just looking at, yeah. I'm looking, there's like a page on this thing. That's what it looks like.
I would say yes.
Yeah, whereas I think his look in the movie, I don't know, he kind of reminds me of like, especially after he gets corrupted by the Necrosword or whatever. He looks like Mumra to me, honestly, but with the caped, the cowl on and everything. But,
well, it was, the funny thing is before he called or texted me earlier to say, hey, man, let's record on it, I was listening to some little little snippets of Did You Know? And apparently in the movie, remember how he's all scarred up?
Yeah.
They took out, there's certain scenes that are missing or cut scenes, and one of them is where he's removing all those religious symbols that are painted on him in the beginning, where he's like tearing them off his flesh.
That's a good point. We should talk about that later, definitely. I read, I don't know, you know, it could be Taika Waititi's an eccentric fellow. So I heard something that there was, this is actually a 4-hour long movie, and they cut 2 hours of it out for the, because the theatrical cut just comes under 2 hours. So
I could see that. I hope they do the full.
I mean, so I'm curious, what are the other 2 hours? Is it all gore? Like, I'm curious. Okay, so here, I'm gonna read the Wikipedia plot, and as we go through this, let's talk about these, because the it's a pretty good summary for a movie that just came out. All right, so it says, after the death of his daughter Love and his pleas for help are ignored by his god Rapu, Gore the God Butcher is called to the god-killing weapon the Necrosword, and uses it to kill Rapu, vowing to kill all gods. I thought that scene was awesome.
Yeah,
I'm a huge fan of that scene. I love when he cut the dude's throat open, and there's just like the gold is pouring out of him, and I was like, oh, that's so rad.
The way the god was just mocking him, and like, I'll just get more follow-up. Dude, it was such an asshole. And Christian Bale is an amazing actor. I saw the pain in his eyes when he's like,
yeah, they did a really good job of showing you that, like, no, these are quote unquote gods, but they're like actually fucking douchebags, right? Yeah. Like not even like the smallest, you know, inkling of remorse. Really, really good. Huge fan of the way they opened up with Gore and all that stuff. And really like the way he was like huddling with his daughter and all the stuff in the beginning. That was all fantastic.
Go ahead.
So I was gonna say, from there we cut to Thor and the Guardians. So did you have anything else that you wanted to say there?
Well, no, and I just want to have a quick question for you. What was the makeup of your theater, like the crowd?
Dude, I don't know. We can talk about, actually, you know, we can talk about our how we saw it, right? So where'd you see that?
I saw it at a local theater.
Theater.
9 o'clock. Yeah, 9 o'clock at night.
Yeah, so we saw an 8:30 showing, and we were sitting right up front. So I honestly couldn't see, you know, the way they do the stadium seating now, there's basically a wall between each section, right? Like people can around on their phones, and you can't even like see their phone. You can't even see their hands, because they have to have so much room for the recliners to recline backwards. It's like the capacity is half of what it used to be in some of these theaters. And we saw it in 3D. It was a smaller 3D. So it wasn't like the big theater. It was one of the small. It was fine. I thought it was okay, but I don't think I needed 3D. Whereas like with Black Widow, that final scene, if you saw it without 3D and with 3D, I think they're like two totally different scenes. I don't think there was really much in this movie. Like, it wasn't bad 3D. And honestly, I kind of forgot it was in 3D at times, which I guess is okay. So I would say it's fine. I don't think you needed to see it 3D. I don't think you missed anything.
Okay.
But no, my old Miss Mac here, we were freaking joking about stopping for some margaritas or something before the movie. Instead, homegirl stops at Total Wine and Spirits and buys a 4-pack of those like little wines in bottles. Yeah. And she just threw them in her purse. So we drank glasses of wine during the movie. It's hilarious. Usually we sneak like a bottle of water in, right? And this time we went to. Instead, she forgot the bottle of water. We had to pay $9 for a bottle of water, but whatever.
So you ghetto-fied your theater.
Oh, 100%. 100%. Wow. And I'll tell you what. We're going to fucking do it again. You hear me? We're going to do it again. You can't stop me. But no, I will. What we did get, though, is we got the cool... we were going to get popcorn, right? And like the small was too small, the large was too large. But they had the giveaway, not the giveaway, but the special commemorative Thor Love and Thunder a popcorn bucket. And it's badass, dude. It's awesome. I'm like, dude, we will use that at home. So we paid a little extra to get the Thor Love and Thunder popcorn bucket. It's all like embossed, like, you know, Stormbreakers on it. And it's like 3D when you touch it and everything. Really, really cool piece. Like I was surprised how good it was. So we picked that up. Anyway, that was my experience. Other than two things then.
I'll have to go to that theater and get me one because I have collected almost every Marvel Cup we've ever gone to see on movie. I have them all still. From like when we went to go see Cap, all the Cap movies, I have a Thor one. I went with Fryhole when we went to see Guardians of the Galaxy 1 or 2, and they were selling these Groot cups where it's like Groot head for the cup. I still have that. Like,
I think I remember that, yeah.
I like collecting those little things. Second thing, I got you beat on your wine because I once went to Taco Cabana and bought taquitos, snuck in half a dozen taquitos into the theater. And the only mistake I made, not realizing it, is I went to go eat the taquitos. The person that was with me was like, you need to shut the fuck up because every time I would take a bite, all you hear...
Crunch. Oh, that's hilarious.
Everybody's
dude.
Eating popcorn two or three times. She looked at me. She's like, fucking loud. And I'm like trying to like slowly eat them or maybe just like slowly crunch the end. It took fucking burrito, fucking forever to eat those fucking six taquitos, though.
That is awesome. And I want to just tell our listeners, if anybody's actually listening to this podcast, please tweet us at Rolled Spine. I want to know what the weirdest things are you've taken into movie theaters or have absorbed or have observed taken in movie theaters. Thank you. Okay.
I've seen someone whip out a large pizza from Pizza Hut.
Get out of here, dude. A large pizza. You know, wait, was this in the 90s where they weren't like JNCO jeans or something?
No, you know what? People walk in with blankets.
Yeah. Oh, really?
This lady walked in and the funny thing was the way she had it was she basically folded the pizza up and put it in a smaller box and then had it in the blanket. So I'm sitting there watching her open this up. What movie was it we went to go see? Fuck, I want to say it might have been when I went to go see not Mad Max, Fury Road.
Fury Road, yeah.
I just remember this lady, she was there with like three kids, and she's up and she's handing them each a piece of pizza and they're eating them and I was just like, holy shit, this bitch just stuck in a pizza, like a whole pizza.
Anyway. I'm not even mad at that.
I was impressed.
All right, let's go back to the plot here. Okay, so from there it says, elsewhere Thor parts ways with the Guardians of the Galaxy after receiving a distress signal for Sif. So that kind of jumps over his whole Korg is narrating the space Viking and how he went to go just chill out and he plants Stormbreaker into the ground and he's just gonna, you know, just call me if you need me or whatever. I thought that whole scene was like classic Thor Ragnarok.
Yeah.
You know, the spaceships those dudes were flying around, the huge cathedral, the aliens that are asking him for help, you know what I mean? Like, I thought all that was fantastic. And then when he pulls his robe off and what do they play, Welcome to the Jungle or whatever, and he just starts smashing all those things. Dude, that was all like fantastic. And then even through to where he's leaving and he's telling him that he can have the ship and take his crew, it's just like, and Star-Lord's like, oh wow, you're gonna let me keep my crew, oh you're gonna let me take my own ship, oh that's great. I thought that was hilarious. I'm totally on board. This is literally Ragnarok 2 and I'm good to go. Like,
you were good on it.
Yeah.
I was pretty good on it. I agree with you on that. It was fun. The handshake was a bit long, but it was goofy, so I was like, okay.
So from there, it says he receives a distress signal from Sif. Upon arrival, a beaten Sif warns Thor that Gore the God Butcher is coming and his next target is New Asgard. I thought the Sif stuff was pretty funny because she was just like, you know, I'm gonna die and go to Valhalla. He's like, oh, you know, you only go to Valhalla if you die on the battlefield. He's like, so maybe your arm is in Valhalla? And I legit snorted red wine out of my nose because I thought that was pretty funny. So from there we go to, you know, Jane Foster is getting chemo treatment and she's sitting next to a dude reading her book and she's going through the Einstein-Rosen bridge. I thought that was pretty good.
Yeah,
and then she's drawn to New Asgard where she sees Mjolnir on display shattered in pieces because Hela destroyed it.
Hold on.
Yeah.
I got a lot of fun facts here for some reason.
Go for it.
So apparently, if you notice that all the parts are on a piece of grass, since no one is worthy to pick up the part, the way they figured out to lift it up was like the whole elevator thing.
Yeah.
Where you can't lift it, but you can lift the ground around it.
Yeah.
So that's why if you notice the grass is lifted, I was like, okay, that's kind
of
cool.
Yeah, they took like the cross section of the earth out.
Yeah, and of course this also, that's another deleted scene where she actually touches the hammer and it comes together. Because apparently, if I remember correctly what the guy said, Hela could destroy the hammer, but she could not destroy the enchantment that's in the hammer. And so that's why the hammer came back together.
Gotcha. Oh, also in that scene, we have another play with Matt Damon and Chris Hemsworth's brother and home dude from Jurassic Park.
Melissa
McCarthy comes out as Hela. I thought that was hilarious, dude. Even with the cheesy, like, play version practical effects to make the hammer go. That was all fantastic. Oh. Huge huge fan of all that.
Okay, so it sounds like you were really digging this movie so far.
Well, I mean, it's just those are all the parts from Ragnarok that I got a kick out of. Even now, I've watched Ragnarok 15 times, dude, and every time it gets to the Dark World, Loki death being acted out, it is just absolutely. And then you know, Loki's disguised as Odin, and he's you know eating grapes, and he's like mouthing the words or whatever. It's hilarious, hilarious. So I knew that was going to happen again in this movie, and it was awesome.
You were good for it. All right.
Yeah, yeah. So Jane Foster gets Thor's hammer, blah blah blah. We find out that you know Thor had accidentally enchanted it because he just said, you know, Mjolnir will always protect you or whatever, and then it you know lights up or whatever. So Thor arrives on New Asgard just as Gore starts attacking with the shadow creatures. He's surprised to find another Thor there. It turns out that's Jane Foster. She looks absolutely ripped jacked. To hell. She's like super jacked, as well as Chris Hemsworth is absurdly jacked in this movie, like CGI looking jacked. While they're fighting all these shadow monsters that kind of seem like they suck, Gore pops up. He kind of gets his ass kicked, and it turns out it's called, I guess, kind of a distraction so they can capture all the kids of New Asgard and whisk them away. So they're trying to figure out how to get the kids back. They travel to Omnipotent City to warn the other gods and ask for help. And at this point, like, Korg's there. So it's Korg, Valkyrie, Jane Foster, Thor, and Thor. Right? That's it. It's just the four of them, right?
Yes.
They travel there and they're going to talk to Zeus and ask him for help in helping to get to. So at this point, right, they've already discussed. Have they figured out at this point that Gore is going to go try and talk to Eternity?
No, not yet.
They don't know that yet, right? They don't know that that's what he needs. Because I don't know if.
Are we talking about when they got already to Omnipotent City? What was it called?
Omnipotent City.
Yes, that's when Zeus tells him that he doesn't have the key to get to Eternity.
Right. And he talked to Axel, right, which is Heimdall's son. So he just saw where they were at. He didn't see yet that they were going to see Eternity. Correct. Right. Okay. Gotcha. Yeah. So that whole scene was pretty funny. I thought that there's also another plot point we missed here. At this point, because Mjolnir is back, Stormbreaker is like jealous of Mjolnir, and there's lots of these weird, like, Thor's running into his ex weapon, and the new weapon is like not acting correct because it's jealous. So they have to like weld it to one of the tourist ships, because New Asgard now is like a tourist trap.
Yeah, it's Disneyland.
Yeah, and then it's towed by two goats that he got as a prize for destroying the enemies with the Guardians in the beginning of the movie.
And I won't lie. I laughed my ass off when those things came out screaming.
You're doing the goat. Goat scream. So the goats are towing this flying Asgardian ship with Stormbreaker attached to it, so they can actually use the Bifrost, because Thor can't use Stormbreaker for the Bifrost because Stormbreaker is mad because Mjolnir's there. You following me with me here, kids? Okay, it's a lot. It's a lot. So there's lots of hijinks that go on in Omnipotent City. We see a bunch of the other gods that are all there to see Zeus, including Korg's god, who's sitting on a throne of scissors. Which, haha, right? Paper, rock, scissors, rock, and a scissor throne instead of a sword throne like Game of Thrones and scissors.
I gotta admit, I thought the dumpling god was pretty fun.
The dumpling god was, but at this point in the movie, though, I have to tell you, though, at this point, I'm still kind of on board. God, I know. The dumpling god, I'm starting to think maybe Taika Waititi is going a little too much on his bullshit, right? Like, this is still a Marvel movie. This is still, right? You know, this isn't, you know, What We Do in the Shadows part 2 or 3. Or whatever the fuck. And I'm like,
which is fantastic. But
okay.
It's his own universe.
That's fine. At that point, I'm like, the dumpling god? Like, okay. Like, I recognize a lot of the, like, there were Aztec gods there and, you know, stuff like that.
Mayan gods.
Right. And then
they had the jaguar god, who's the Black Panther.
Did I miss that? Gotcha.
Yeah, she's right below Valkyrie and Mighty Thor. She's sitting below them.
I totally whiffed on that. But there's a lot going on. And so I was trying to, like, catch things, and I ended up missing more probably than I caught. So Zeus comes down with his lightning bolt, does a big entrance. Of course, he's just like the gaudiest of the gods, and
What did you think of Russell Crowe?
I thought that it was great that he was doing like a Grecian accent. You know what I mean? He wasn't just another Australian guy, and then he was kind of like a greasy Grecian. You know, there was something hilarious about the way they portrayed him. I was big thumbs up on that.
This is gonna sound dumb. I absolutely love the part where he's walking down to Thor.
Yes,
he picks up his shirt. Yeah, the theater. Erupted in laughter.
Yeah.
Real quick. So we're getting to that scene we're going to talk about. the makeup of my theater, which was really weird, I would say was more women than men. There was at least six women. There was at least six women next to me with their kids. There was a row of about eight women in front of me with one guy, two dudes next to me, and there was like two guys and then like four girls with them. So just in my two rows was mostly women compared to men. Now, I can't speak for the entire theater, but I thought that was really strange that I had seen more women in a theater than men at a Marvel movie before.
So you're talking about where they blast all Thor's clothes off, right?
Yes. And dude, the women definitely reacted to that.
They went nuts. There was not really a reaction in my theater, but I was kind of expecting that. Yeah, I was expecting there to be. Maybe people were choking on, you know, their popcorn or whatever. Dude is absurdly jacked in this movie.
Yeah.
Like I'm kind of scared for him. He's so jacked.
It can't be healthy.
No, this can't be healthy, dude. Like that's outrageous. Like I felt like his face kind of looks a little different. Like his face was more vascular and everything. Like he's fucking out of control, dude. Anyway, no reaction in my theater for that. But look, dude.
Oh wow.
Chris Hemsworth, freaking dope ass dude. Look good for that guy. Give the lady something. I got no problem with that.
So Mrs. Mack didn't even react to it?
No, she did for sure.
Oh, okay.
She did. I think she blacked out for a few minutes. Anyway, so they steal the lightning bolt, right? And they fire it through Zeus's chest or whatever. Doesn't all that shit go down?
He tells him he's not going to help him. He's gonna flick the disguises of everybody else, and they all take off their robes of the emotion god. And I believe that's what she's like. Can we do it now? And he's like, attack. And so they attack. Yeah. And that's when Zeus strikes Korg, because they're beating the shit out of all of Zeus.
Oh, soldiers. Yeah.
He strikes Korg, and Korg is falling apart, which people in my theater really freaked out. Even that caught me off guard. I'm like, oh shit, they're going to kill Korg? Like, really? And he's falling apart. And that's when Thor grabs a bolt and shoots it through Zeus, and his body just rocks and it gets stuck to the back. Valkyrie goes to grab it. All the gods are freaking out. But of course, this is the time where Thor's trying to get all the gods together, and Zeus is kind of telling him, look, dude, we're scared of this dude. Like, we're going to stay here. No one can find us. You can't leave now because you know where we're at, and he might get you to tell you where we are. So you're stuck here with us now. And we're going to have orgies and stuff.
Yeah, you're not invited to the orgy. So anyway, they need the lightning bolt, because I guess the lightning bolt can summon the Bifrost too. At this point, they're kind of not really giving a shit anymore, in my opinion. They're not obeying the rules of their own universe at this point. Yeah, at this point now, everybody's got a fucking Bifrost, and everybody can carry every fucking hammer. Nobody really cares. So let's speed this up a little bit. Okay, so Gore is trying to get Thor and Stormbreaker to rescue the kids so that he can use the Bifrost to get to Eternity, because basically Eternity's like a magic genie, and whoever finds him first gets one wish, and his wish would be to kill all the gods. So they're basically like, they got to go get these kids, and they got to take Stormbreaker to get the kids out. So they go to the Shadow Realm, which is all black and white. It's kind of pretty cool when they showed up there, and everything kind of turns black and white. The kids are gone. They fight Gore.
You didn't tell me how you felt about Korg being killed like that.
Oh, cool. I didn't give a shit.
Really?
Oh, yeah, wow. I didn't give a shit. Korg started to get a little annoying, in my opinion. Okay. It was like Taika Waititi found a way to make himself a co-star of the movie, and I didn't need. I wanted more Jane Foster and Thor. I didn't need more Korg and Thor, to be honest with you. And it was a lot of Korg. It was a lot of Korg in this movie. And then it was just like one more. I don't want to start giving away all my likes and dislikes, but then it was just, so we already had the goats screaming all the time, and now we had like the Korg face, because they pull his face out of the rubble almost like a baby Groot, right? Yeah. And then, so now we have these goats that are screaming every time the goats go everywhere, and now we got Korg's face everywhere, and it was just sort of like, okay, like what is the plot of this fucking movie? Did we only go to Omnipotent City to take Chris Hemsworth's clothes off and to just make Korg even more annoying? Was that the whole reason we went? Like, I felt at this point they're just doing shit in the movie to tell more jokes, right? Instead of like moving the plot along. Anyway, they go, they fight
so
Gore.
So it sounds they're kind of losing you here now.
They're starting to lose me here. Gore gets Stormbreaker. He opens a portal to Eternity. Valkyrie gets fucked up. And at some point in all this, they get back to Earth and they find out that like Jane is actually not being saved by Mjolnir, but Mjolnir is actually killing her because it's sapping her strength away. Mm-hmm. So she's not able to fight the cancer because everything in her body is going to being Thor, which is weird. So he basically tells her, like, don't ever be Thor again. If you ever pick up Mjolnir again, it's going to kill you. I'm going to go handle Gore on my own. So he's still got Zeus's lightning bolt, which now can summon the Bifrost. He goes, gets to Gore, finds the kids, and then endows endows them with Thor's godly power to give them, they all have Thor's power briefly to fight all these shadow monsters that Gore is conjuring.
Yes.
Gore starts to kick Thor's ass. Jane says, fuck it, picks up the hammer. And now the hammer can now summon the Bifrost. How does she get there? I don't know. Gets there, kind of starts kicking Gore's ass. They end up defeating Gore. Gore does not get
there. Actually, no.
He makes it to eternity, and Thor convinces him that with his wish, he doesn't need to kill all the gods, but he can actually bring her back. Because at this point, Jane Foster has died. She's passed away from cancer, right?
No. She's dying, and that's when Gore realizes he's dying as well, because to hold on to that blade is corrupt you and kill you. So his dying wish is, instead of killing the god, to bring back his daughter, and he asked Thor to take care of her. And of course, at that same time, Jane Foster's passing away.
Right, but I think part of it too was that he's seeing that, like, Thor's losing the one he loves, and he's actually got a chance. He's got a chance to actually change it and bring her back, and Thor can't. That's what I meant. She was going to die. She hadn't died yet, right? But it didn't matter. It's the same effect.
I gotta admit, I did like the fact that they didn't wish Jane Foster back or anything.
Right.
Like, they definitely rode that horse out.
So that's how the movie ends. Gore wishes for his daughter, whose name, I guess, is Love. I guess I missed that throughout the whole fucking movie until I was reading this Wikipedia. They wish her back instead of killing all the gods. Thor raises her. And the end scene. Then Jane dies.
Blew through the movie. Yeah.
Well, I mean, the movie. That's kind of that's kind of the end of it, dude. They fight Gore a couple times, but that's really, it's Gore. We go back and there's some flashbacks and then more Gore.
Well, you find out that Gore's back. He's having a baby. Valkyrie is now teaching the little Thor or the children of Asgard how to defend themselves. What's her name? Now the one-armed
Sif.
Sif is now teaching Heimdall's kid. I'll agree with you. When the kids got the Thor, that kind of took me out of the movie.
Then don't forget the big ending is that Thor is living with Gore's daughter, and she has Stormbreaker now, has
that. I believe this is the part I was confused in.
Uh-huh.
If you look as when he looks at her, when you look at the reflection of the water, she looks like Eternity. She has the whole sky gate. So
I missed that. I didn't see that.
Oh, you didn't notice that? Yeah. If you looked at her, if you looked at the water, her reflection, she had white eyes, and she had the whole system inside of her, like Eternity. So my assumption was Eternity, you know, went into a small human form and is basically, because she shoots laser beams at the end and ruins the pan, and Gore's race didn't do that. So that tells me that she's something more than, if anything, she looks like the kid.
Well, she's also she's wielding Stormbreaker too, so she has all those powers, the electricity powers. Yeah. So who fucking knows, right? Now they're like both Thors, assuming, which also makes you think, because that's what they've been doing in all these Marvel shows, that now Chris Hemsworth leaves and now she's Thor, which makes my brain want to throw up. And then the mid-credit scene is Zeus did not die, right?
Well, he's dying.
Yeah, and then they reveal that he's, you know, got somebody that can go after Thor, and it's Hercules. And he's played by fucking home dude from, do you ever watch Ted Lasso? It's Roy fucking Kent from Ted Lasso.
No.
You don't watch Ted Lasso? He's like the most, probably outside of Ted Lasso himself, he's probably the most popular character in Ted Lasso. He's fucking hilarious. So he's going to be Hercules.
Okay.
Which I was not mad. That was definitely a better mid-credit scene than the fucking Eternals with Star Fox and Pip the Troll. Made me want to fucking kill myself. This one I was like, oh, okay, cool. But then as soon as I saw Hercules, I like realized Thor in the Marvel Cinematic Universe is the fucking MCU Hercules, right? Hercules is kooky. He's a goofball. He goes on these wild space adventures. Like that's Thor in the Marvel Cinematic Universe, but that's Hercules in the book. So they're probably going to flip, you know what I mean? Where he's going to be this like hard ass, take no bullshit Greek god or Roman god. I don't know which one it is. Whereas Thor is the kooky freaking goofball. It's like weird. They had this weird like reversal of fortune. And then there's another post-credit scene where Jane Foster's in Valhalla and she meets Heimdall. And doesn't he like allude that she's got bigger things that she's supposed to do or something?
I thought they were going to show when he points up to the palace. I thought she was going to look up there and there was going to be Loki or something like that.
Oh, no shit. That would have been way better.
Yeah,
that would have been way better.
That's what I assumed whenever he was talking to her, and I'm sitting there looking, I'm like, oh shit, they're gonna show Loki. But then I realized, no wait, Loki has his own show right now.
Yeah, he's the TVA right now, right? Yeah.
Yeah, so I'm like, okay. But that would have been kind of cool. Or different.
Okay, so I'm gonna go through my goods and bads and you tell me if you agree or disagree. All right. Okay. The Matt Damon play was fucking hilarious.
I agree.
Chris Hemsworth just kind of did his thing in this movie. I didn't think he was any better or worse than he was in Ragnarok. Let me see. I thought the movie was gorgeous. I thought all it was just like Ragnarok. The creature creation was awesome. awesome. I think Gore could have looked a little cooler. He looked a little basic, but you also didn't want to go too. You didn't want to go too far, so you couldn't tell who the fuck he was, like they did. What's his name in Dark World? So I was fine with that. I thought Christian Bale was fantastic in this movie, and I really wanted more Christian Bale and Gore. He really didn't do shit in this movie for his I'd been avoiding any sort of spoilers or reviews, but pretty much everybody had said that Christian Bale was fucking incredible in this movie, and he was really, really good. He just didn't have a lot to do, which I thought was a little unfortunate. And I thought Natalie Portman was great. She freaking bulked. She bulked the hell up. She could have mailed in this movie because apparently she was all pissed off at Marvel at some point. But I thought she did a really good job. She had some weird, like where the scene where she's trying to come up with her tagline or whatever, it felt a little forced. Mm-hmm. But like all the cancer stuff, I thought she did a fantastic job. I had no anytime she and Hemsworth have great chemistry. I don't mind them at all in these movies. But also, I would have liked more Jane Foster in this movie, more Jane Foster and Thor. Like I didn't need. I guess we'll go to the stuff I didn't want. I didn't need Valkyrie in this movie like at all.
But she really wasn't in the movie that much.
She was, but again, any scene she was in was a scene taking away from Gore or Jane Foster, which I think you needed more of both of those. Any scene Korg was in was taking away from Thor, Jane Foster, and Gore. And those, in my opinion, were the three strongest characters in this movie. So anybody they put in that kind of got annoying with little jokes and quips, I would have rather had another Gore scene. Give me more Gore. Give me Gore where he's carving the god symbols off his head. I want that. Yeah. I don't need a conversation between Valkyrie and Korg on the bridge of the ship. Like I don't need that. Get that the fuck out of the movie. I don't care about that. Let me see what else we got here. That's kind of my main thing. The movie stopped being funny and it started just being silly. And I think that there's a fine line between funny and silly. And I think Ragnarok gets close to that line, but for the most part is very funny. This movie just kind of started being silly, where it was like every time they could, they had the fucking goats screaming. So we had goats screaming and Korg doing stupid shit and Valkyrie just standing around. And it was just like, we got to go somewhere else to tell another dumb joke or attempt a joke. And it really started getting on my nerves. And then I started realizing like, we don't give a shit about the actual story here. You're not doing anything to show me why Gore is so fucking mad he's going on this tirade and how Zeus has heard and is scared of him. Well, show me how. Show me. Like that gigantic god that was dead where Lady Sif was and he got her arm cut off. Show me that. Show me him kill that giant god and show me him cutting Sif's arm off. I want to see that. I want to see why Gore is scared. Why Zeus is scared. Why show me. Yeah. And you didn't. You know what I mean? And I was just like, man, show me. And then he just kind of shows up to New Asgard and he steals the kids to set up a trap for Stormbreaker. Stormbreaker's there at New Asgard. He's there. Why is that not the fucking trap? I don't understand. And then he's supposed to be this really bad dude who just fucking slaughters everyone. Well, he's really, really nice to these Asgardian kids, dude. He's just like, these are the nicest kids ever. I'm keeping them in this little cage. And then he gets Stormbreaker. Where as soon as he got Stormbreaker, I'm like, oh shit, he's going to kill these fucking kids because he doesn't need him to lure them anymore. No, he just leaves the kids like alive hanging back there. And I'm like, well, that doesn't sound like a god butcher to me. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah. Well, what bothered me was there were some scenes like, okay, as much as I like Gore, I hated the scene where he's in the cell with the kid and he does the whole puppet thing and he ripped the head off. And that just, those are moments that I felt like, what's his name again? The director?
Taika Waititi.
Yeah. Taika went too far. He went into his little goofy verse that he likes doing these little goofy things. And it just kind of doesn't go with the movie. Those were scenes I was just kind of like, I didn't need this scene. Like, this is kind of like, it doesn't make any sense that he's trying to befriend the kids or what is he trying to do here? Is he trying to intimidate the kids so they call Thor faster? Or like, he's not on a fucking time clock or anything. It's not like it's going to end at a certain time. So that felt weird. I really got disappointed with the whole, let me power up all the kids and they're going to run around and have electricity and they're killing these demons and they're doing it in really cutesy, funny ways. And I'm just like, that's not funny. Like,
it was very Care Bear stare. And I'm just like, what is this? Is this the power pack or something? Like, I don't care about any. And then like the whole Stormbreaker Mjolnir love story where like Stormbreaker's mad at him. I'm like, I don't need any of this shit in the movie. I don't need any of it. But they needed it for the boat so that they can have the goats that he got. You know what I mean? It's like he just wanted some screaming goats on screen the entire fucking movie. And the only way to do that was to create this whole plot line where Stormbreaker's mad at Thor. And it was just like the first time they did it, it was like kind of funny. But then I was like, holy shit, this is like a major plot point in the whole fucking movie. I'm like, I don't need any of this, dude. And then, like I said, by the time he's giving the kids powers, Jane Foster's showing up without having anything to summon the Bifrost. And it's just like, you don't give a do you even give a shit about any of this stuff? And that's when I'm just like, you know what? I don't think Taika Waititi gives a shit about this fucking superhero movie bullshit. I think he kind of got lucky with Ragnarok that everybody loved the Sakaar stuff so much. Because the Hela stuff sucks in that movie. Like, her hair changes in every single scene. Sometimes within the scene, her hair would change. And I'm like, did he even edit this? Did he even pay attention to it? And it was, I felt like that in this movie too. I felt like Jane, she would get, like, her face would be all fucking beat up. And I'm like, they just started fighting and she looked fine. And then they would cut away and they cut back and she's like beat to hell. And it was the same thing. I felt like Gore's face changed a lot in this show. And you never explained, I guess, because he's getting more corrupted? I don't know.
Yeah.
It's those little details. That shit's so sloppy. It's like really sloppy. And that was like the word for this movie. This movie is fucking sloppy as fuck, dude. It's just shit thrown all over the place because he wanted to get three or four funny bits in. And I kind of didn't like it like at all. Like, I kind of didn't like this movie. By the end of it, I'm like, I'm never going to watch this movie again.
Oh, ever. Wow, really?
No, I'm never going to watch this movie again, dude. Why would I watch this fucking movie again? To watch Gore's daughter get saved because see Eternity turn into a magic genie? Like, what? Like, I don't know, man. It was just, let me see if there's anything else on my list. Yeah, I said I need 70% less Korg and I need 70% more Gore and I need 50% less jokes. That would have made this movie way better. I
would probably watch it again in a while. It doesn't have the review or the rewatchability of Ragnarok. I'll give you that. It had its good moment, but it just like you said, it broke its own rules too many times, and that kind of, it took the fun out of it. Like I said, I'm still harping on the whole Kid Thor thing. I was like, that wasn't funny. Like, that didn't need to be in the movie. I didn't need any of that thing.
Well, and you follow that up with Jane dies of cancer.
Yeah,
like, it's just the weirdest mixture of storylines. She's dying of fucking cancer, and then we've also got screaming goats and a love affair or a love triangle between a hammer, an axe, and Thor. And I'm just like, what the fuck are we doing in this? This movie is just whereas like Ragnarok had two storylines and that was it. This movie had kind of one storyline, and he was like, well, we got to make it go a fucking million different places. And I was just like, I don't even want to say my hopes were high for this movie. But I don't know. I think this one got. I think Marvel's getting got. I think they've had some of these. They're like, oh, you know what? Like, Taika Waititi was a semi-known director, and we just let him do his own thing, and it worked out really, really well. So we're gonna go out and just get all these directors, and we're gonna just let them do whatever the fuck they want. And I think they're getting miss after miss after. I mean, I think Shang-Chi. A lot of people love Shang-Chi. I think it was a miss. Eternals, huge miss. I think this movie's a miss. I loved the Multiverse of Madness. A lot of people didn't like Multiverse of Madness. I liked Black Widow. A lot of people think Black Widow is like the worst of these Phase 4 movies.
What?
Which is not. This is not a good fucking sign, dude. I think this phase is big time trouble. Where, you know, I mean, I see Kevin Feige doing damage control. Like, don't worry, this is all building up to something. And we're all like, what's it building up to? You're what? Five movies in now? You want to rank these real quick? It should be easy. Black Widow. So we have Black Widow, then No Way Home, Shang-Chi, Multiverse of Madness, Thor, and Eternals. You think you can rank those real fast? I'll give you my rank while you're thinking about it.
Okay, go ahead.
I still think Black Widow to me is the best of these movies. I love that movie. I rewatched it a bunch. I love it. Multiverse of Madness is number two. No Way Home is three. And I'd put Thor and Shang-Chi as a tie with Eternals way, way, way last, because I keep forgetting that movie even exists until somebody tells me.
My list is almost exactly like yours. I would 100% agree with your list on those.
Well, I know you like No Way Home more than me, but that should just show you that's...
But I really, really like Black Widow. I think it's a fantastic movie. It has everything you need in it. I really, really like Madness too. Those two are my two favorite of this phase. I really like No Way Home too. I do see its problem, but I still enjoyed it. But it's more of a nostalgia. But the other two are brand new ideas, and No Way Home is kind of harping on my nostalgia bone.
Huge fan service nostalgia.
So I enjoy it, but I understand what their crutches were. And I'm like, okay. Where the other two are brand new, I'm telling you, Madness is fantastic. Like, would put Black Widow and Madness like almost close. It's just Black Widow has that little bit more. It's just a better driven story, where Madness does have its weak spots where it just kind of, I don't know. But as far as the movies, I mean, Black Widow to me, I've rewatched that one. Shit, I've lost count. That's one we could just throw on and my whole family enjoys it.
Yeah.
Spider-Man the same way. Eternals and Love and Thunder.
Well, don't forget Shang-Chi.
And Shang-Chi. Actually, I would probably put Eternals and Thor pretty close to each other. And Shang-Chi I could do without. I've only seen it twice. Once in the theater, and I was like, and and I watched it again just because I was like, well, maybe I'd give it a chance. It just wasn't for me. I didn't enjoy it. It wasn't a very good kung fu movie. It wasn't a cool adventure movie. That the girlfriend, the best friend, she was their version of the screaming goat.
Yeah. She was like Korg and the screaming goats all rolled together.
I was like, yeah, she annoyed me half the movie. So I put that as last. Thor and Eternals decided to put them close to each other, but Eternals had some cool, like, I love the whole celestial shit. I love when they do the space shit. But the character and some of the cool stuff, like, I did like, you know, where they're kind of using their powers on humans. So I thought that was kind of neat, but it was just long and boring. Yeah. Like, the monsters were just so there was no imagination to them.
So,
giant plant looking creatures.
I'm going by rewatchability. I've watched Black Widow a ton of times. I'll probably watch it again. Multiverse of Madness, I haven't gotten around to watching it again because I've been trying to get through Stranger Things and The Boys, but it's on we want to watch it again, like, ASAP. In fact, we probably would have watched it tonight if we weren't recording. No Way Home, I need to check out No Way Home again. Thor, I can see me maybe watching it one more time, but like Shang-Chi and Eternals, I'm never going to watch those movies again. Yeah. So that's the only but I put Thor and Shang-Chi in a tie, but there's a chance I'll at least watch Thor once. I ain't ever watching Shang-Chi again. I was bored to tears during that movie, and Eternals was even more boring than that.
Yeah.
So yeah, man, I really wanted to like this movie. And then, like, I don't even know. The Guns N' Roses stuff almost got on my nerves, and the fact that they named Heimdall's kid Axel, I'm just like, this shit is like not funny. You know what I mean? Like, I don't think that this is funny at all. This is not James Gunn's use of music correctly. This is like that first Suicide Squad movie's use, where you're just chucking Guns N' Roses everywhere, and they're like, hey, we're gonna call him Axel, just like Axel Rose. And I'm just like, what is the oh man? Because what, we had November Rain in it, and we had Welcome to the Jungle and all that stuff.
It was like four different songs in it.
Like, I should have been into it. I wasn't into it. It was not presented correctly, in my opinion. And then also, like, instead of Jane saving him in the end or having the shitty kids, when Thor was getting beat, maybe the Guardians should have shown back up to help them. You know what I mean? Like, yeah. Something like that. And it was just, no, he's going to give the kids superpowers. And then also, I gotta tell you, I wasn't really a huge fan of Jane able to like scatter the pieces of Mjolnir around. I thought that was a little like, a thing?
I thought that was interesting. I don't think so. I don't remember that in the book. I thought it was a nice little take on the weapon. Just instead of just throwing one hammer, it would break up. I thought that was cool.
It was okay. I don't know. I guess of all the licenses taken in this movie, that was probably not the worst one. But anyway, man, I wanted to like it. I don't think I liked it. I wouldn't even say it was okay. I'm looking at Rotten Tomatoes. Not that Rotten Tomatoes gives a shit, because Black Widow's got a horrible Rotten Tomatoes score, but it's not being reviewed well by, I'm not saying the audience score, but like the actual like score is not, I think it's down like 68%, if not lower. Which, man, I'm not even sure. What's Thor Dark World at? Honestly, man, I think I like Thor Dark World better than this movie.
Really?
Yeah, just to be honest with you. I think
the problem was in Ragnarok, you had just the right mixture of action, drama, and comedy. Where this one, it was more comedy and sometimes scenes where you really don't need comedy, and they just felt like they needed to inject it there. I don't.
That's a good point though, right? So one of the main critiques of Ragnarok was that they killed like the Warriors 3, and nobody even gave a shit, right? And I was like, well, nobody cared about those characters anyway, so it's okay. But then in this movie, where they were recapping all the bad stuff that's happened to Thor, they were like, and this guy got killed, and this guy, and whatever this guy's name is. Like, it's like he knows people are pissed about it, and then like shat on them more in this one. And I didn't like that either, dude. I don't like that either. Like, it's one thing for you to kill them off quickly so you can get to your other story, but it's another thing to gloss over his friends from the first two movies in the flashback where you're trying to show how bad his life has been over the last couple years. Like, you're making a joke out of the pain you're trying to show us. You know what I mean? Like, I don't know.
Yeah.
So I'm not even mad about it in Ragnarok. I'm more mad about it in this movie than I was in Ragnarok. So that's when I was just like, I don't think Taika Waititi gives a shit about these Marvel movies. He's collecting this check and he's doing a fun movie with Chris Hemsworth, but I was not impressed with this outing at all.
I think what it was he's like, I do think he gives a shit, but I think he was like, everyone liked how kooky I was in the first one, so I'm gonna turn up the kookiness to 11, and they're really gonna love this movie. And I'm just like, no, we should have kept the kooky at 5 and, you know, balanced everything else around it. Like I said, it there were just some scenes, it got kooky, I guess I would say, and it just was like, okay, that's no.
I don't think so. I don't think he was like, hey, people liked how kooky it was. I think Taika Waititi is just like, I'm going to do whatever I want. Watch me spend $300 million however I want. I'm going to make this just ridiculous movie. I don't know, man. Again, maybe there's like a gore cut we can get where there's way more gore.
I'm pretty sure they're going to do like the ultimate cut and just like put everything in there that wasn't in this one.
Like, dude, I guarantee you the deleted scenes for this movie, you're going to be like, that should have been in the fucking movie. That should have been in the fuck. I guarantee you like half of them, you'll be like, that should have been in the movie. And in fact, that's actually why the main crux or main motivation for me to watch this movie again is to see the deleted scenes. Because I guarantee you, you're going to be like, holy shit, why didn't we get that scene instead of the hammer and the axe arguing, right? So I don't know, man. I just thought the movie had tons of potential and it was whack. This movie was, how about that? There's my review. This movie was whack. And wow. I don't care for it. I will spend my time watching Doctor Strange. Like, dude, Doctor Strange had some pretty shitty reviews. It's 74% on Rotten Tomatoes versus, and same thing with Black Widow. Black Widow's like 76. This was 68. It's only 2% over,
Dark World.
Dark World. So, and I don't see this number going up. This movie's going to come down. Yeah. I don't know, man. Super disappointed. All of Phase 4, I've been fairly lukewarm on, and this one's
bleh. I'm going to say this movie was not dope, and that's about it.
It was not dope. This movie was not dope. Okay, I got you, man. All right, cool, dude. Well, go ahead.
So then we agree, then Thor, Love and Thunder is the backdoor man to the Marvel Universe, then.
It could be, depending on your interpretation of it. Okay. It could be. I needed more Led Zeppelin and less Guns N' Roses in this movie. For sure.
Yeah, very disappointing.
You see any movies this weekend?
Oh, yeah. I saw Thor, Love and Thunder.
Yeah, I'm about 20 minutes through your episode. I've got a few notes. The whole Jason Aaron thing, like y'all were talking about that a bit, I think he finally wrapped it up like maybe last year. Because he'd made his name on Scalped for Vertigo, and then he moved over to Marvel, and like the entire time since he moved over to Marvel, he was doing Thor until like a year or so ago. And the Jane Foster thing ran for a good 4 of those years, I think. So it's like to hear that they'd gone through that entire arc in one movie seems a little slight. But it seems a little slight.
Yeah, it's basically a subplot of the movie.
Yeah, I was going to throw in there that my thinking was that Christian Bale looked most like the Grim Reaper from Bill and Ted.
Okay, I could see that.
Sadler, yeah.
They Melvin'd me.
I was going to mention that I also have some of those embossed metal popcorn containers. One of the local chains, it's run by the son of a guy who I think ran like Cinemark or AMC or something. And so in order to help differentiate that line, they were importing those because those were made for the UK market, I think for Odeon or something. And so they were an early adopter of those. And I guess they're getting around more now, but that's how I ended up getting those two popcorn bins. So those are the ones I've got. I'm glad they finally addressed Sif in the movies. It does sound like she's given short shrift in this thing, but at least they acknowledge that she exists to some degree. Rory Kent, I hope that at some point over the last few years, I've mentioned my own theory that Thor had morphed into Hercules, because if I didn't, then curses, because I can't believe you beat me to it. I'm not sure about, was the Roy Kent guy like buff? Did they like get him onto the Chris Hemsworth diet, or does he still look like the Ted Lasso guy?
I mean, he's pretty big in Ted Lasso. He's not like 6'6 or anything.
Right. But he's Hercules, so he's got to be like a monster, I would think.
Yeah, I think the, I mean, I don't know. Sometimes I think that casting on looks maybe isn't the best thing. Let me see. I think I can find like a picture of it. I found one still that I don't think really does it. Let me see. See if I can paste this into the chat. Paste it into the chat. It's not a good still. I need better still than this. I mean, he's a pretty big dude, and if he goes on the fucking Chris Hemsworth steroid diet and fucking horse tranquilizers, he can get big. I don't know. I just don't know how tall.
Oh, that's definitely CGI. He isn't really that big, is he?
I think that's definitely his face CGI'd onto. Yeah. No, I know.
Like,
but
perspective. Is size enhancement going in the future.
But it was also like as the camera is like panning up to him, so it's going to look really, I mean, it's CGI, but I don't know how yoked they're going to get him for this movie. I mean, I was reading an article, we didn't talk about this podcast, we can talk about it now. I was reading an article where Chris Hemsworth and Taika Waititi were watching the fucking premiere, and at the end of the movie, it says Thor will return. And they both looked at each other and they were like, what the fuck? Because they're not signed on for anything else. Like, Chris Hemsworth has no contract to be in anything else. And they're like, that was news to us. And so I mean, I would like to say, I don't know what they have planned for Roy Kent Hercules, but I can't imagine, like, apparently the dudes that made this movie don't have a clue. I don't even know if they knew that scene was in it, right? Because it's a post-credit shit. I don't even know. So who knows what they have planned? I don't know. He might have 3 years to get insanely jacked. I don't know.
Did they do that? Because I heard, kept hearing something like they announced Avengers Incursions. Was that a real thing or some bullshit Twitter thing?
Not that I've seen.
Because I thought they were working toward Secret Wars. I thought that was I thought that was where Phase 4 was going with Secret Wars, because everything's been multiverse and like duplicates of all the heroes and shit, you know, so.
But I mean, I'll say this. The dude looks like he could be Hercules, correct? Because he should be a Grecian, not like American white guy or Australian.
Semitic quality to him.
Yeah, I mean, I think if they can get him to put on a 75 pounds of muscle, which, look, they've done it to all these other dudes, so I don't know why this guy can't do it.
But yeah, that's actually one of the things I have enjoyed about the himbo version of Thor, is he does remind me so much of Hercules, and I always liked Hercules more than Thor anyway. So I'm kind of down for that, to see them maybe do a role reversal. It'd be weird if they try to out-himbo each other, though, because I really think Hemsworth's got a real advantage in that department.
Yeah, and I honestly, I'd like to kind of see the two of them go at it. I think that would be, I think their contrasting personalities could be pretty cool. Unless, like you said, they clone them and they're both goofy. I don't know. Or maybe they'll turn Hercules into MCU's Thor and make him be a little more serious. Mm-hmm. I don't know. I'm curious about it, but I mean, you know, whatever.
Well, it's one of those things where they keep, they had a big thing on Twitter about how Ms. Marvel isn't getting the numbers of some of the other shows. And I got like 15 minutes into Ms. Marvel with Paquita, thinking that maybe she would like it, and she couldn't stand it. She hated it more than I did, and I could have at least finished the episode, but I wasn't into it at all. And it's like, these are characters that were introduced well after my time. They're not the type of characters I like, regardless of what color they are, so I don't think it makes me a racist, so I just don't want to watch Miss fucking Marvel. Whereas, you know, Hercules was a guy that I read when I was a kid, so I'm going to be more excited for Hercules, and it's got nothing to do with him being a white dude, especially if they kind of play him a little bit more swarthy in the movies. It's just that that's the stuff that I grew up on, so I'm going to get more excited for that than I am for this newer stuff that's, you know, got a smaller audience, basically. I mean, if you something you introduced in comic books in the last 15 to 20 years, you're introducing to an audience of like 20 to 50,000 people. You know, they're just not that well widely read anymore. So you just don't have generations of enthusiasm. So it's just annoying to me that you're automatically the bad guy if you're just not that into some of these newer characters that you didn't grow up on. You don't have fucking fond childhood memories of and shit. So, you know, I get tired of people getting fucking irate. It's like, figure out what you're getting irate about and maybe think it through a little bit before you decide to just go for the most slanderous fucking conclusions and shit. Pisses me off.
Well, yeah, I mean, like, look, X-Men 1 sold, what was it, 8 million copies? Mm-hmm. How much does an issue of, has every Ms. Marvel comic book combined double counting, right? Because the same person's buying every single episode. Like, you know, put it all together, have they sold 8 million comics?
I doubt, seriously, that they've sold 8 million Ms. Marvel comics, even if you, like, just set aside the trades and stuff, because I know that they keep a lot of that stuff in print. If you just go on by raw numbers, every issue of Ms. Marvel having run probably somewhere in the realm of, well, I mean, okay, so with Captain Marvel, we have the thing where she goes from being Ms. Marvel to Captain Marvel, so it gets a little fuzzier there. But when they started pushing her as their answer to Wonder Woman in the mid-2000s or maybe into the 2010s, because it was around the same time that you had the Mighty Avengers with Bendis and stuff, I doubt that if you combined all those comic books, you would get to 8 million. You know, I seriously doubt you'd get to 4 million, you know, so yeah, you're onto something on that front.
So, I mean, it's just obvious. The numbers game is just obvious. Game.
Yeah.
Like, you know what I'm saying? I mean, I don't know.
Well, and the fact is, with Captain Marvel, since it was dealing with material that I did have affection for, not only was she taking on the legacy of the original Marvel, but she was also supposed to be picking up threads from the Kree stuff that was laid out in S.H.I.E.L.D., I went into that movie excited, and they didn't exploit any of that stuff. So it's like, you had a way to hook me into this character that I'm not as familiar with. I know her as, like, binary, you know, from my generation. But they didn't take advantage of that. So is that my fault or is that Marvel's fault? I think it's Marvel's fault, personally.
Yeah, I mean, I think everybody, I mean, just to take a step back with the whole, I think everybody's kind of checked out on all the Phase 4 stuff. I mean, the numbers are just falling. I mean, you figured the next Thor movie would have, you know, blown the doors off the box office. I thought Doctor Strange was going to blow the doors off. And they're all just kind of, I mean, they're making tons of money, but it's just not.
The enthusiasm, you know, isn't there.
No Way Home appears to be the exception, mm-hmm. right? But this could also just be the new
high. I don't know if you noticed, but Doctor Strange is on Disney Plus now, but No Way Home still isn't. You still have to rent No Way Home.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
We watched Doctor Strange last night, so mm-hmm. I definitely know that.
That's yeah, right. And Paquita watched it over the weekend again, because she liked it enough to rewatch it. But, you know, No Way Home, I guess they're still making money off of it, so why would you diminish that by putting it on for free on Disney Plus when a lot of people have that service now.
Yeah, it's it could just be this is just the new high watermark, right? And now look, and Top Gun did really well. I've heard really good things about Top Gun. It sounds like it's better than the original, because I think
that's pretty much universally. People are shocked by how much emotional heft it has. The first Top Gun is pop, like it's cotton candy. Like there's nothing, even when they kill off Goose, spoiler, nobody's like super emotionally invested in that movie. You're enjoying it for the music and the attitude and everything else, the cinematography, where people are like plugged into this. You know, this is like almost like the Requiem for the last, you know, movie star and Tom Cruise and shit. Like people are really into this movie. I mean, you don't make that kind of money, especially on a non-franchise property. I mean, this is one of the only times Cruise does a sequel at all. You don't make that kind of money unless you've got something special, you know, because there's no built-in momentum to get to that kind of number. You're having to pull in new audiences to get to those kind of numbers. And Top Gun on Amazon Prime is not going to do that.
Yeah, and I've heard people geeking out on everything, like on the airplanes that were used, and they did the full immersion where like the lingo is even accurate and all that stuff. You know, so I think that's also I think Top Gun's an exception, but also Top Gun is a sequel to a 1980s film, right? It's got the previous legs, right? It's not like, Tom Cruise came up with an obscure concept about the Top Gun flight school. No, I mean, this is very much a sequel, right?
And the 80s have been really thoroughly fetishized, especially in recent years. Just look at fucking Stranger Things and the numbers that's pulling in there, too. It's like, you know, all of a sudden Kate Bush and Metallica are back in the top 10, you know? It's a weird time right now when it comes to the 80s material.
Yeah, right. And so,
I think that there is a draw to actually doing stuff, like showing actual things happening. I think there may be an element of burnout to CGI, but also, like, you can tell me how it is with Love and Thunder, but, you know, a lot of the Marvel stuff, it's not seeming to have the same quality of CGI as it used to. And I'm hearing that basically the FX houses are rebelling. They're tired of doing these gigantic movies where they're spending 6 months to a year working on the visuals and still being under time pressure and work pressure. And it's like, we'd rather do six different jobs, make the same money that the one job is making us, and be under less pressure and you know, be able to do better quality of work. So it looks like Marvel might be losing that edge, since the FX guys aren't wanting to work with them anymore, it seems like, from what I'm hearing.
Yeah, it seems like all the recent Marvel films, you'll have like one scene where they really put the money into it, and the rest of the movie is just kind of like the opening sequence to Love and Thunder, that's in a lot of the trailers, where he takes the robe off and he's in the Thunderstrike outfit and everything, that all looks fantastic, but I really don't think the rest of the movie looks nearly as good as that opening scene does. But you know, I don't know, man. It's just CGI. I don't know. Some people think CGI looks awesome. Some people think it looks terrible. It's whatever. Hey, I sent you the post credit scene. It doesn't look as CGI.
Wait while I play it?
I mean, it's a post credit scene. It's like 25 seconds long.
Okay.
Do you understand me, Oculus? Do you understand me, my son?
Yes, father.
Okay, I'm kind of into that.
Yeah, it's not as bad. Like I said, you're seeing stills of motion. I think it looks a little weirder than if you actually watch it in motion.
And I agree with you, too. I like that they're using a Grecian accent. That is cool.
Yeah. There were lots of good parts of the movie. Whatever. You folks just listen to the podcast. Are you tacking this on at the end? Are you going to put this in the podcast?
Yeah. This is tacked on at the end. This isn't just a bullshit. The one other thing, too, is the reason why Natalie Portman was pissed off is because Patty Jenkins was supposed to direct Thor to Dark World. And then when she didn't, and they got a guy, and she didn't have anything interesting to do, and they basically Marvel had gone back with their promise to her to have a female director for the sequel. That's what pissed her off, in case anybody was curious about that.
Yeah, I mean, I keep seeing the headline over and over again, but I don't click on the links, so because I don't.
I remember that from when it was happening. You know, I think she made noise during production, but certainly within a couple of years of production, she was talking about it because she didn't show up for those other movies. They kept using old footage and recycled audio and stuff. I think she might have recorded some new material for one of them, maybe. But no, I mean, it's been well known that there's a reason why she didn't come back for anything until now.
Yeah, I think we've talked about it on the podcast before. Yeah. That sounds familiar. It's just I don't care.
Yeah,
I don't care why celebrity A threw a hissy fit over celebrity. Who cares? You got paid for the role. Shut the fuck up. And you came back and got paid again. So what are we doing here? Anyway, any other points on Love and Thunder you want to talk about?
No, but I was going to mention that what we went to see this weekend instead was The Black Phone, and I think things worked out the way they were supposed to, because I know Scott Derrickson wanted to do a more horror horrific movie for the Doctor Strange sequel than Marvel was willing to let him do. That was the argument they kept making. And of course, they had all that fucking falderall about Sam Raimi made a R-rated Doctor Strange movie and blah, blah, blah. It's like, yeah, no, it isn't R-rated. Get the fuck out of here. Black Phone is R-rated. And it is a dark movie, and it's definitely a full-on horror movie. And so I think that everybody ended up where they needed to be. And I would recommend folks go ahead and check out The Black Phone.
Did you, you brought up Stranger Things earlier. Did you watch this last season of Stranger? Are you guys even watching Stranger Things?
I tapped out after the third season. I couldn't stand that show anymore. It just got on my nerves. Yeah. But Paquita watched it, and she loves it. She was saying it was the best season ever. So, you know.
I think it's definitely the I still think the first season is the best season. It's definitely, in my opinion, the second best. The third season was not good. Where it's just the whole
which is weird because everybody was bitching about the second season, where it was the third season that turned me off completely.
Yeah, I mean, that's why I said this was easily the second best season after the first. The problem is that even this season, oh, man, dude, it was like, I don't know if you saw the run times on these fucking episodes. It was like,
I've been hearing about it. That's a big part of it. Anyway, but also they're like feature length, it seems like.
Dude, it started out like an hour and six. I'm like, oh damn, this is like a solid hour. This isn't like a 55. This is an hour and six. And then it was like an hour and here, I'll read them off because it gets progressively ridiculous to where you're just like, I can't watch more than one of these like per night. Like this is, I don't know how you binge a show when each episode goes over. No. Cancel. So it goes an hour and 18, an hour 17, an hour and 4, an hour and 19, an hour and 16, an hour and 15, an hour and 38, an hour and 25, and then 2 hours and 30 minutes for the final episode. That shit's too fucking long.
Those are movies. They occasionally would make fun because there was a few movies. I think Nick Cage did a Top Gun knockoff back in the 90s. It only ran about an hour 15. And they were making fun of how short it was and how that wasn't quite substantial enough to make a motion picture. But once you get in the hour 20 range, that's a feature, you know? And every one of those episodes is close to that. And it's, like you said, it's a TV show. And what I hear is it's kind of fatty. I heard it's good, but also they run a little long and they kind of wear out their welcome.
Yeah, and there's only like one real storyline you really like, mm-hmm. and the other ones are all just sort of converging to that storyline, but they still give them fucking 40, you know, 30 minutes of screen time in some of these episodes. And I'm like, I don't care about this storyline. I know where this is going. I know you're going to eventually, we're all going to end up in the same spot. Get me back to the Kate Bush storyline. Okay, that's the storyline we all like. Let's keep going there. And you take us to, you know, and it's just like, And then it kind of pays off in the final episode, but all you can think back is, wow, this could have been, you know, 9 hour long episodes or 7. You could have cut 2 whole episodes out entirely. I don't know. And like literally one, the Hopper storyline in Russia, the whole show could have just done without. We didn't need that entire, it had nothing to do with the rest of the show. You could have just got rid of it. As much as I liked seeing him being in Russia, because it reminded me of Black Widow, the whole storyline didn't need to be in the entire show. But by the end of that episode, it was like, okay, whatever. I forgive the show. The first 4 episodes were good enough, and the last episode was good. That, you know, that's 5 of the 9 were really good. So whatever. But it was especially when we've been banking the Boys episodes, and I'm just like, I can't wait for those shows to. I cannot wait for the next episode to come out. And when it's over, I'm like, what the fuck? That was a 55 minute episode. That felt like it was 30 minutes. And then you're going to a Stranger Things episode, and it's like, because you know each storyline that's running in the episode will have its own end within the episode, and you're like, well, that's got to be the end of the episode. And you're waiting for the credits, and it's like, no, we're going to storyline C, and we're gonna wrap that one, that little chapter up in this episode. You're like, oh shit, they gotta wrap up every single storyline within every single episode, right, to give it its own little mini conclusion to pick up in the next episode. So the episodes just keep ending and ending and ending, and they just don't ever end. You know what I mean? It's just a very stark contrast to the pacing of the two television shows. So
and that's how you guys have been wearing me down, because I refused to buy The Boys when it was coming out, because it came out from Dynamite and it was like $4 a pop, and I wasn't willing to go $4 for a single comic book, and I just kept, you know, deferring on that book for years now. But they'd offered the omnibus, and it's like, well, I want to read the comics before I watch the show, and everybody keeps telling me how great the show is, and especially now this Marvel ennui is set in. I'll read on Twitter where it's like every episode of season 3 of The Boys is better than the latest Marvel movie, and it's like, I kind of want to jump on that shit.
Dude, I'm just going to tell you this, and I don't want you to I'm not trying to bait you into watching the show. I don't know if there's a show on TV that is anti-MAGA Trump as The Boys. It is
That's one of the things they were talking about too. People somehow managed to miss that for the first 2.5 seasons, and it wasn't until they got even more explicit this season that people finally started waking up. It's like, oh wait, you're making fun of us?
Yeah.
I heard fan of the Homelander.
I heard The Boys like Reddit page like was basically set on fire with all these people who were rebelling, because this whole time they thought that like Homelander was the fucking fucking good guy. I'm like, how do you think he's the fucking good guy? He's a god. He's a fucking rapist. Like, what are you talking? And then this one, they were just like, okay, this is our in utero. We like, we're going to go over the top and show you how you didn't get it before. You're gonna get it now. I mean, it's
we're gonna shake off the jock bros with this one.
It's insane. Dude. It's insane. The show's it's perfectly cast. The effects are great. The costumes are fantastic. The storylines are extremely relevant to what's going on planet Earth right now. It's our favorite show. When episode 8 ended, we were like, tell us there's a 9th episode in the season. It's like, no, it's just 8 again. And it's like, this fucking sucks. I gotta wait another year for the show to come back out. And then what do we have left on the docket? Obi-Wan Kenobi? It's like, I don't want to watch that shit. We're not gonna fucking watch that. So we were trying to find random documentaries on Netflix tonight. We're out of shit to watch.
Paper Girls is coming up, and that was a great comic, so I'm looking forward to watching the show. I think that's Hulu.
Okay. We got that.
Paper Girls will be out for the end of the month, and I'm sure I'll be one of the only ones who's excited for this, but Resident Evil starts at the end of the week.
Okay. I think we've got some trashy reality dating shows that are starting back up soon, so maybe we'll mix in some Resident Evil or something. Mm-hmm. But yeah, anyway. Okay, sorry, we hadn't talked about Stranger Things since like season 1 on this podcast, so, and not that you have to have any of that in there. Okay, so let's do the permanent Marvelite Maximus followers, Hamid Nemati, Side by Side Podcast. What do you mean you've never seen?
Podcast. Keepers of the Favorites Flame, Billets by Vinyl, Dear Watchers, a Comics Omniverse Podcast, Do Blue, Doc Strange, Gregory Litchfield, Hello Berlin, Jason Snick Venable, Jeffrey Brown, They Them, John is Reading Dragonlance All Summer, Kenny Crayley Jr., MB, Mike at Reanimike, Mike at Send Aliens to Me, MM Beats, Montana Malone, Moose the Hobo with High Kick Matson, My Comic Book Collection 70s to 90s, Nick Spence, PP93, Salacious Rum, Scott X, Shanna Banana, Siskoid, Sox Fan 2021, Too Dangerous, and Villian Mendonca.
Retweet Frantic Ones, Between the Pages Blog, CH, Lawrence, Talk Nerdy to Me.
Among the Nuff Sayers was pretty much just Keith G. Baker saying, thank you for featuring Nickelback throughout the show. They're freaking boss. And then Mac over here responded with Kirk screaming, con! And then Keith came back with Mr. Rourke from Fantasy Island, just basically shrugging him off. And then finally, Kyle Benning added Dwight Schrute saying, let's put it this way, no.
I enjoyed that GIF exchange because he pulled out a Ricardo Montalbán GIF to reply with. Excellent job.
The expanded Ricardo Montalbán universe, mine.
The Ricardo Montalbán Corinthian cinematic universe. All right. The Mary Marvel Marching Society, 21st Century Boys, and Anthony Cut the Shit Tony, Billy Hines, Chris Leiden, Dirk Ashton, who added Thank You RSP, Ed Moore, Eugene R. Hendricks, The Hammer Strikes, History of Comics on Film, Palmar D. Oliveira, Hulking, Iowa's Joe Is, Keith G. Baker, King Size Comics Giant Size Fun Podcast, Mario DC, Marvel Universe Online Project, Mike Davenport, The Nerd Stylistic, Nerdstalgic Podcast, Randy Caldwell, Resurrections and Adam Warlock and Thanos Podcast, Richard Field, Sean McLaughlin, Superbound, Thunderbolt Max, Tim Price the Podcrasher, and Weird Warriors Podcast.
I can't be the only one who always wants to say Mario DC likes to keep it clean.
Oh, little Beastie Boys drop.
Drop?
I always approve. Drop. I missed that. I had my own opportunity and I fucked it up.
The Marvel Superheroes Podcast is in no way affiliated with or endorsed by Marvel Entertainment. All characters mentioned and audio clips employed are believed covered under fair use, with no infringement intended against their copyright holders. The views expressed in this podcast are assumed legitimate, truthful, and solely possessed by the speaker.
Another thing that we can bring up real quick that has do not put this in the podcast, you don't have to, but there's like this weird made up narrative that people didn't like Thor because it was too gay. Mm. Have you seen this? I don't know what. Not only have I not seen anybody say Korg's planet, this is the only gay thing in the whole movie. Yeah. Okay. Korg says on his planet, they're all male. So his two dads, they go into like a cave and they hold hands for like 6 months and then a baby's born. Uh-huh. And then at the end of the movie, he talks about how he wants to go, how he meets a guy and they go down. That's the only, we're talking combined, this is 15 seconds worth of dialogue in the whole movie. I don't see anybody. So now I see people saying it. Oh, I hope they make the next one even gayer, so all you people can. No, I don't think that's why people are not liking the movie. Like, I'm not seeing that as the.
Oh well, let's be honest though. There, it's definitely a reason for some people to not like the movie, and there's definitely agenda to enhance that.
No, there is no gay in the. There is no gay.
No, I'm saying there are people who have zero tolerance and or they hate Marvel in general, and they'll fucking attack it on any grounds, even that grounds. I thought that all got started because at one point Taika said that Thor was so gay, you know, like as a derogatory, as kind of a jokey derogatory, and then people started getting pissed off at him because he used gay as a derogatory, you know, you can't do that, blah blah blah. So I that's what I had heard about that.
I haven't heard any of that shit. I all I see is people is like defending the movie. I don't see anybody actually attack. Like, this isn't like Lightyear where I saw people actively saying, get all the queers off the you know, it was like nonstop. Mm-hmm. Which, by the way, we took kids to go see Lightyear. It was perfectly fine. The same gender kiss scene, they're both at that point in like their 70s. So it's just two old ladies giving each other like a kiss on the cheek. Mm-hmm. Like, it is so, it was so fucking, it was so little. They probably shouldn't have put it in the movie at all because it was, it's not worth the fuck. It's not like you made the main character gay and he and his boyfriend are going on. Like, you didn't go that far. This was, you went so little into it that it wasn't worth you putting it in the movie because you basically bombed the box office because you made this decision.
It seems like a lot of people were pissed off about the Tim Allen recasting too. Like, I think they made that like a big point of that. It's like, oh, what are you doing? You're canceling the conservative actors and blah blah blah. And there's like,
yeah, except I saw an interview with Tim Allen. Tim Allen's like, I'm the toy. This is the movie the toy's based off of. So Chris Hemsworth or Chris Evans is the guy, and I'm the toy. Mm-hmm. Like, even he was like, he goes, I do the voice of the toy. You know what I mean? And it was just like, okay, so if Tim Allen gets it, and it's because it's just made up. They had to come up with as many things as possible to shit on the movie because there's gay people in it. I get that. I don't see any of that with Thor. The only context I see is people defending it for being gay against nobody. I don't see anybody attacking it for that. It's like the weirdest talking point. It reminds me of the Ms. Marvel thing where it's like, hey, Ms. Marvel's kind of boring and it sucks. I don't care about the character. You fucking misogynist. It's like, no. I didn't say I didn't like her because she's Indian or because she's a woman. Like, no, nobody's saying that.
By the way, are you watching that?
I don't know. It's weird shit. Huh?
Ms. Marvel, are you watching that?
No.
Yeah. Doesn't look very appealing, right?
No. It looks like WB39 or Nickelodeon. Looks like a Nickelodeon show with a little girl who's a superhero. I'm just not interested in it.
Well, and also like they fucked up her powers and they changed her origin and somehow it ties into fucking Clandestine. It's like, why don't you just keep the Inhuman stuff? You know, you've brought back Black Bolt already in Doctor Strange. Why can't you fucking keep her Inhumans connections and not piss off the fans? The whole thing with Marvel is that they kept the shit that people were nitpicky about and didn't piss them off by making changes that were arbitrary. And now they're doing the fucking DC shit. And then they're wondering why they're getting DC responses to that shit. Like, you don't fuck with a character's powers, you know? It's just like, I've already told you my misgivings about Anthony Mackie and having Sam Wilson be Captain America. And like I said, I'm going to go see the movies because they're going to have Captain America villains and Captain America story arcs and shit. But there's still something that takes me out of it when Captain America is flying with wings on. It's like, but that's not a Cap thing. And it's got nothing to do with any of the other stuff. It's just that, why is Captain America flying? It's like, Cap doesn't fly. So it's like, you know, it's like if suddenly Iron Man didn't fly and you're like, why isn't Iron Man flying? That's kind of one of his things. You know, it's just, it fucks with, like, he's running places now. Why? He's back to the roller skates. It's like, what? It's part of what you like about a character is what they do, how they do the thing that they do, that the particular dynamism they have. I get off on Cap bouncing around, doing the acrobatics and, you know, bouncing off of walls and shit, throwing the shield. And then when I see Sam, it's like, why does he even have the shield? Why would you, you know, he's got the wings, so do shit with the wings. Why are you running around with a shield taking up one of your arms? It's just the logistics of it just like take me out of it because like that's not what
does Cap that fuck does. Up your aerodynamics?
Yeah.
How do you fly with a shield in your hand?
That's you're off balance. You know, it's just a basic thing. So I don't, you know, whatever. It's got nothing to do with progress or racism or anything else. Just like Cap doesn't fly. So what, you know, if that's your Cap, great. That's your Cap. Then I'll be a Steve Rogers fan, but I'll probably still support the Cap movies because at least they're still dealing with Cap shit, and I'm into Cap shit.
Yeah, and they just the one thing I actually think everybody agrees on is this Phase 4 Marvel shit is just completely rudderless, and they don't have a clue what they're doing.
Yeah,
and I think Feige even comes, don't worry, it's all building up to something, and it's just like, well, remember how you build up stuff before where you would like tease a common foe, do you remember how you actually like tease everything coming together? That's like absolutely nothing like what you're doing now. This shit is like Black Widow's wrapping up storylines, and like there is no like what is No Way Home building up to?
Mm-hmm.
It's not fucking building up to anything. What a Multiverse of Madness built up to, like maybe another Doctor Strange movie, I guess. Maybe the Klee or Klee we stole.
Yeah. Well, she mentions the incursions, so I'm assuming that that's going to take Doctor Strange into Secret Wars or whatever else they're going to do with that.
Okay.
But it's just like there's no genuine enthusiasm, because one of the things that got people so excited after Avengers was we know Thanos. We love Thanos, and we're really wanting to see what's going to happen when the Infinity Gauntlet finally happens, you know? Where I still assume they're doing Secret Wars, but they're doing Secret Wars as though we're Crisis on Infinite Earths, like they did the one from a few years ago. And like what people loved about Secret Wars, and hopefully they're going to do this still, is you've got the X-Men and you've got the Avengers and you've got the Masters of Evil, essentially, and like all the big villains. They're all on one planet. They're having to fight each other and shit. So you'll maybe get there if they actually get the actors from the old X-Men movies, and they, you know, they play up the fact that they've got these different franchises that are all coming together again. But because that's not being built up anywhere besides a Multiverse of Madness, plus the joke that they keep making, and they even did it for the Honest trailers, is that it's a Multiverse of Madness where they only go to like a couple of universes, and you know, they go to a universe where they have red lights instead of green lights, you know, who gives a shit, where you've got everything everywhere all at once. That's a true multiversal movie, and it's like your whole Phase 4 is about the multiverse, and this little indie movie is doing a better job of multiverse shit than you guys are doing with all your millions and billions of dollars. So yeah, it's definitely a fucking mess right now. And again, we got excited for Thor and Cap and Iron Man, and people just aren't getting as excited for this other shit.
I mean, yeah, there's what, like 6 of these Phase 4 movies already, and I don't, there's fucking nothing going on. Mm-hmm. And I think I'm pretty sure I am on record at some point in our years of podcasting saying that maybe it would be better if they just made standalone superhero movies, mm-hmm. and let directors do what they wanted to do. And I'm sure that was probably after Ragnarok, where we're like, oh, you bring in Taika Waititi, let him go fucking crazy. Except they've kind of been doing that now, and all these movies suck.
Yeah.
So they don't suck. They're just really mediocre.
Yeah, really, really mediocre. Exactly. It's like, there's none of these movies that have come out that I have any great desire to watch over again. I'm glad Strange, and I'll watch Doctor Strange again, because again, that was a much better Doctor Strange movie than the first one that actually did Doctor Strange shit. So I appreciate that. And again, it's Raimi, so definitely one of, if not the best of the phase, but not a single one of them is Iron Man. Not a single one of them is Iron Man 2, you know?
Yeah, well, and unfortunately, I saw Black Widow was trending, so I just clicked it, which I should.
Oh yeah, I forget that's Phase 4, because that really doesn't feel like Phase 4. It feels like a coda to Phase 3. So I forgot about Black Widow. I do like that one too.
So whenever I clicked the hashtag, it was rank the Phase 4 movies, and I'm like, oh fuck, I shouldn't have clicked this. And I started scrolling through, and dude, it is Shang-Chi is the best, or No Way Home is the best, and Black Widow, Multiverse of Madness, and Eternals would cycle at the worst.
Yeah.
And I'm just like, god damn. Like, other than Eternals, like, we are on opposite ends of the spectrum. Like, I've seen Black Widow 5 times, I think, already. Like, maybe 6 times.
What the fuck is their problem with Black Widow? Seriously.
Is it just that she was dead
and they didn't care anymore? I don't understand. Is it because they're pissed off at ScarJo for racial appropriation or some shit? I don't. It's a fun fucking movie. It gave us Yelena. We all love Yelena. What the fuck's the problem? I don't understand these people.
The weirdest fucking hit job on that movie. I don't get it.
Is it
I'm not saying it's perfect.
You think it's perfect. It can't just be the misogynists, because I've seen people on the other side of the spectrum who hate on it. It's like, what do you hate? It's really fun. It's a good movie. What the fuck's your problem?
I saw one where it was like, oh, you mean where they were joking about her hysterectomy? You think that, like, the worst fucking movie ever? And I'm like, oh my god. Okay. I was like, moving on. But yeah, but you know, I just don't get it, dude. And like, Shang-Chi was like the most mediocre of movies I've ever seen. It's just completely meh.
It's one of those early 2000s Jackie Chan cash grabs. It's a fucking Tuxedo.
Yeah, but
like you said, I can't stand that guy now.
It was literally like Shang-Chi brought back practical fight scenes and got rid of all the CGI. And I'm like, did we watch the same movie?
Well, not just that. They're not even good fights. Those are shit fights.
Yeah. I've said it before. The one between Cumberbatch and Chiwetel Ejiofor in fucking Multiverse of Madness, where they have the fucking bracelets on so they don't have any powers and actually fight. It's a fucking fantastic fight scene between two magicians. But it's a great Extremely well choreographed fight scene, but yeah, it doesn't get any credit. People hate that movie. They hate Multiverse of Madness, and that one I still don't know why. Mm-hmm. I don't actually see it verbalized why. It's just that people hate it, and I'm like, I don't get it. But eh, whatever, man. All I know is that Thor: Love and Thunder is already almost at Dark World Rotten Tomatoes already. Mm-hmm. I don't think it's gonna tick up at any point. So anyway, not that Rotten Tomatoes, who gives a fucking shit, right?
Well, it's just like they were given some movie recently. We watched X, and X was fucking horrible. It was so fuck. I mean, no, it wasn't horrible. It was just completely and utterly lame. You know, it's lousy as softcore, and it's lousy as horror, and it's completely predictable. Almost everything about the movie was in the trailer. It was just a complete waste of time, and yet it was highly rated because I guess it's elevated horror. So yeah, you're right. Rotten. It's just like, you know, they were so hard on the early Marvel movies, and now all the reviewers are like super fucking easy pushovers with all the Marvel movies right now, and giving them way more credit than they deserve, even though, like you say, they're all super mediocre. There aren't enough professional film critics anymore. It's all a bunch of fanboys, and it just seems like they coast on vibes and like whatever the social media winds are blowing. You know, I don't even understand what the fuck's going on anymore in this world.
I mean, I don't know, dude. The Thor, that's the critic score is in the mid 60s, mixed to high 60s. I mean, it seems like pretty universally where like this movie. I was gonna tell you to name this Thor Love and Thor 5. Taika Waititi jumps the goat as opposed to the shark, because there are goats in this fucking movie. It's like not even like the people who are probably like, we love Taika Waititi's vision and he's so, you know, charismatic and eccentric. We'd love that he finally took one of these boring superhero movies and done it. No, it's just across the board. Like, what the fuck was this shit? Like, you know,
I mean, nearly every review I've read, whether it's been Twitter or mainstream, has been, it's a funny, fun movie that's a fucking complete mess and doesn't amount to a lot and basically undermines itself because it's so concerned about making you laugh constantly that it can't lean into the pathos that's inherent in the material.
He abandons his storyline. Yeah. Just completely abandons
it. And given how I reacted to Ragnarok, it totally sounds like I will have the exact same reaction to this one, if not worse, with this one. So it's like, no, I'll watch it when it hits Disney Plus, which probably from the sound of it would be a few weeks out.
Yeah, I mean, and like, luckily it's less than 2 hours. I think it's like 1 hour and 59 minutes.
I think it's 2:05, so it's just barely over 2 hours. Well, remember, they have like 10 minutes of fucking credits and shit, so they're going to count that too.
Well, whatever. I'm saying it says one. Whenever I type in runtime, it says 1:59. It's not, if it were very much longer than this, it would turn into, I fucking hate this movie. Mm-hmm. It was still short enough where I'm like, oh man, like, they're chasing down Christian Bale. I'm like, this has got to be like the end battle because.
No, you're right. It is 1:59. Okay.
Yeah. I mean, and then luckily it was. It was like, okay, that's it. The movie's over. Thank God that's over.
Yeah.
Because it was just really, really disappointing, dude.
Several times I saw they said it was a feature length SNL skit. It's just a series of SNL skits run together, strung together as a movie.
Yeah. 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 It's like if Chris Hemsworth hosted an episode of SNL and they had him keep dressing up as Thor and would put him in these fucking weird and bring these like weird looking characters out. I'm like, hey, I'm Sif. I'm missing an arm or whatever. And it's just like, ha, 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 ha. But that's what it was. It was every single scene. I don't know if you got to the point of the podcast where I say it, but it's like he made the plot to get to the skit he wanted to tell, mm-hmm. as opposed to the skits happening along the plot. That's what it was. It was, they got to find a way to get to this place because I want to have Russell Crowe be kind of a slightly prissy Zeus. So we got to get there somehow. And if he could use the Bifrost with Stormbreaker, well, that's not going to work. He would never go there. So we got to find a way to fucking break that. You know, it's like he's because he wants to have this one scene where they blow Thor's clothes off and Russell Crowe gets to act like a weird Grecian, like prissy god. And that's fine. But you should do it from the other way where it happens along like a sensible plot. Like, that's why I really like Multiverse of Madness, is because they followed their own rules within their own universe. This movie is the opposite of that, where by the end of it, he's just like, whatever. They're just there. But they're like, wasn't the whole first half of the movie? You have to have Bifrost. Yeah, yeah. I don't care. They got to be able to get there because that's how all the characters have to be in one spot at the end of the movie. Okay. So they're just there now. Yeah, they're just there. It doesn't matter. Okay. Well, if you don't give a shit anymore, I don't give a shit anymore. Right. Anyway. Yeah. It's weird. It's really weird. And I unfortunately didn't mention the podcast either. The one of the main plot devices is Gore's daughter who dies in the beginning of the movie. That's Chris Hemsworth's daughter. I did not realize that. I believe, unless I misread that headline. All I know, it doesn't fucking matter. It doesn't matter. All right, man.
Yeah, I know. I think we've tapped it out.
Yeah.
All right.